Hi, my name is Ahmed, and I work on the Clang and Swift compilers. In this session, we're going to dive deep into changes we've made to make common Swift and Objective-C operations faster and more efficient, so that we can improve your app size and runtime performance. When you write code in Swift or Objective-C, you're always really interacting with two major components. First, you build using Xcode that uses the Swift and Clang compilers. But when you run your app, a lot of the heavy lifting is done in the Swift and Objective-C runtime. The runtime is embedded in the operating systems for all of our platforms. What the compiler cannot do at build time, the runtime does well at runtime. We're going to look at several improvements we've made in both compilers and runtimes. Now, this session is a bit unusual. There are no new APIs, language changes, or new build settings. You don't have to change your code, so all these improvements are transparent to you, the developer. Let's dive in. We're going to look at four improvements. We've made protocol checks in Swift more efficient. We've also made Objective-C message send calls smaller, as we did retain and release calls. And finally, we've made auto-release elision faster and smaller. Let's take a closer look. Let's start with protocol checks in Swift. Here, we have a custom loggable protocol. It has a read-only computed property custom log string, and we can use it in our log function that has special handling for custom loggable objects. Later, we're defining an event type with name and date fields, and we're conforming to the custom loggable protocol by defining the getter for the custom log string property. And this lets us pass event objects to our log function. When we execute this code, the log function needs to check whether the value we pass conforms to the protocol. And it does that using the as operator. You may also have seen the is operator. Whenever possible, this check is optimized the way at build time in the compiler. However, we don't always have enough information yet. So this often needs to happen in the runtime with the help of protocol check metadata we compute earlier. With this metadata, the runtime knows whether this particular object really does conform to the protocol, and the check succeeds. Part of the metadata is built at compile time, but a lot can only be built at launch time, particularly when using generics. When you use a lot of protocols, this can add up to hundreds of milliseconds. On real-world apps, we've seen this take up to half of the launch time. With the new Swift runtime, we now pre-compute these ahead of time, as part of the DYLD closure for the app executable and any dylib it uses at launch. Best of all, this is enabled even for existing apps when running on iOS 16, tvOS 16, or watchOS 9. If you'd like to learn more about DYLD and launch closures, watch the talk App Startup Time, Past, Present, and Future. That was protocol checks in Swift. Let's move on to message send. With the new compilers and linker in Xcode 14, we've made message send calls up to 8 bytes smaller, down from 12 in ARM64. As we'll see in just a moment, message send is really everywhere, so this adds up, and we've seen up to 2% code size improvements on binaries. This is enabled automatically when building with Xcode 14, even if you use an older OS release as deployment target. It defaults to a balance of size win and performance, but you can opt into optimizing for size only, using the opc stub small linker flag. Now let's look into what changed. So let's start with an example. Here, we're trying to make an NS date for the start day of the conference. We start by making an NS calendar, and we fill out NS date components, make a date out of that, and finally return it. Now let's look at the assembly the compiler generates. Now the details of the assembly aren't super important. Us compiler folks stare at it all day so that you don't have to. What's important is that almost every line here ends up needing an instruction to call opc message send, even when doing property accesses, like we do here for the date components. This is because at compile time, we don't know which method to call, and it's only the opc runtime that does. So we call into the runtime using opc message send to ask it to find the right method. So let's focus on one of these calls. We already mentioned the instruction to call opc message send. But there's more. To tell the runtime which method to call, we have to pass a selector to these opc message send calls. That needs a couple more instructions to prepare the selector. When we look at the binary, each of these instructions takes a little bit of space. On ARM64, that's 4 bytes each. So for each of these opc message send calls, we're using 12 bytes. And we need that for every single one of these calls, and that really adds up. So let's see what we can do to improve that. Now, as we've seen before, 8 of those bytes are dedicated to preparing the selector. Interesting thing is, for any given selector, it's always the same code. And this is where our optimization comes in. So this is always the same code. We can share it and only emit it once per selector instead of every time we do a message send. We can take it out and put it into a little helper function and call that function instead. Over many calls using the same selector, we can save all of these instruction bytes. We call this helper function a selector stub. We still need to call the real opc message send function though, so we continue on to that. And again, that has another different indirection to load the address of the function itself and call it. The details aren't important, but what's important is that we need another several bytes of code to do that. And this is where you can choose which mode you want, as I mentioned earlier. We can either keep these two little stub functions separate, like we've done here. We get to share the most code and make these functions as small as possible. But unfortunately, this would do two calls back-to-back, which is not ideal for performance. So we can further improve this with an alternative version. We can take these two stub functions we've created, combine them into one. That way, we keep the code closer together, and we don't need as many calls. And that's on the right here. So these are the two options. You can choose whether to optimize for size alone and get the maximum size savings available. You can enable that using the opc stub small linker flag. Or you can use the code generation that provides size benefits while keeping the best performance. And unless you're severely size constrained, we recommend using this, and that's why it's the default. And that was smaller message send using stubs. Another improvement we've made is making retain release cheaper. With the new compilers in Xcode 14, retain release calls are now up to 4 bytes smaller, down from 8 on ARM64. And as we'll see in just a moment, just like message send, retain release is also everywhere. So this adds up, and we've seen up to 2% more code size improvements on binaries. Now, unlike message send stubs, this does need runtime support. So you'll get this automatically as you migrate to a deployment target, iOS 16, tvOS 16, or watchOS 9. Now let's look into what changed. So let's go back to our example. We talked about message send calls, but with automatic reference counting, or ARC, we also end up with a lot of retain release calls inserted by the compiler. At a very high level, whenever we make a copy of a pointer to an object, we need to increment its retain count to keep it live. And here, this happens with our variables cal, date component, and the date. We do that by calling into the runtime using opc retain. When the variables go out of scope, we then need to decrement the retain count using opc release. Of course, part of the benefit of ARC is all the compiler magic that eliminates a lot of these calls to keep them to a minimum. And we're going to go into one of these magic tricks a little bit later. But even with all the magic, we still often need these calls. In this example, we end up needing to release our local copies of calendar and date components. Under the hood, these opc retain release functions are just plain C functions. Take a single argument, the object to be released. So with ARC, the compiler inserts calls to these C functions, passing the appropriate object pointers. Because of that, these calls have to respect the C calling convention, defined by our Platform Application Binary Interface, or ABI. Concretely, what that means is that we need even more code to do these calls, to pass the pointer and the write register. So we end up with a few additional move instructions just for that. And that's where our new optimization comes in. By specializing retain release with a custom calling convention, we can opportunistically use the write variant depending on where the object pointer already is, so that we don't need to move it. Concretely, what this means is we get rid of a bunch of redundant code for all these calls. And again, while this may not seem like much for these puny little instructions, over an entire app it really adds up. That's how we made retain release operations cheaper. Finally, let's talk about auto-release elision. Now this one's even more interesting. With opc runtime changes, we've made auto-release elision faster. That happens automatically for existing apps when you run them on the new OS releases. Building on top of that, with additional compiler changes, we also made the code smaller. And you get the size benefit automatically as you migrate to deployment target of iOS 16, tvOS 16, and watchOS 9. Now this is all great, but what's auto-release elision in the first place? Let's go back to our example. I mentioned earlier that ARC already gives us a lot of compiler magic to optimize retains and releases. So let's focus on one case here, auto-released return values. In this example, we made a temporary object and we're returning it to our caller. So let's look at how that works. So we have our temporary, the date, we return it, the call completes, and the caller saves it to its own variable. So let's see how that works with arc. Arc inserts a retain in the caller and a release in the called function. Here, when we return our temporary object, we need to release it first in the function because it's going out of scope. But we can't do that just yet because it doesn't have any other references yet. If we did release it, it would be destroyed before we even return, and that's no good. So a special convention is used to be able to return the temporary. We auto-release it before the return so that the caller can then retain it. You've likely seen auto-release and auto-release pools before. It's simply a way to defer release until some later point. Runtime doesn't really make any guarantees as to when the release happens, but as long as it's not right here right now, it's convenient because it lets us return this temporary object. Now, this isn't free. There is some overhead to doing an auto-release. This is where auto-release elision comes in. So to understand how that works, let's look at the assembly and retrace this return. When we call auto-release, that goes into the OpsC runtime, and that's where the fun begins. The runtime tries to recognize what's happening, that we're returning an auto-released value. To help it out, the compiler emits a special marker that we never use otherwise. It's there to tell the runtime that this is eligible for auto-release elision. And it's followed by the retain that we will execute later. But right now, we're still in the auto-release, and when we do it, the runtime loads a special marker instruction as data and compares it to see if it is the special marker value it expects. If it is, that means the compiler told the runtime that we're returning a temporary that will immediately be retained. And this lets us elide, or remove, matching auto-release and retain calls. And that's auto-release elision. However, this is not free either. Loading code as data isn't something that's super common otherwise, so it's not optimal on the CPUs. We can do better. So let's retrace the return sequence again, this time using the new way. We started at the auto-release. That still goes into the Objective-C runtime. At this point, we actually already have valuable information, the return address. It tells us where we need to return to after this function completes execution. So we can keep track of that. Thankfully, getting the return address is very cheap. It's just a pointer, and we can store it on the side. We then leave the runtime auto-release call. We return to the caller, and we re-enter the runtime when doing the retain. And this is where the new bit of magic happens. At that point, we can look at where we are, get a pointer to our current return address. So in the runtime, we can compare this pointer we just got while doing the retain with the one we saved earlier when we were doing the auto-release. And since we're just comparing two pointers, this is super cheap. We don't need to do expensive memory accesses. The comparison succeeds, we know we can elide the auto-release retain pair, and we get to improve some performance. And on top of that, now that we don't need to compare the special mark instruction as data anymore, we don't need it, so we can remove it. That lets us save some code size as well. That's how we made auto-release elision faster and smaller. We went through several Swift and Objective-C runtime improvements. Let's wrap up. When your app is run on the new OS, thanks to the improvements in the runtime, Swift protocol checks are more efficient. Every time we try to do auto-release elision, that's faster too. Thanks to the new compilers and linker in Xcode 14 and message send stubs, you can save up to 2% of code size by rebuilding your app. And finally, when you update your deployment target to iOS 16, tvOS 16, or watchOS 9, you can further save another 2% by making retain release calls smaller, and even more thanks to the smaller auto-release elision sequence. I hope you enjoyed this deep dive into the Swift and Objective-C runtimes, and thanks for watching.